Going home. It has a powerful pull, doesn't it? Mayfield hasn't been my home for a long time now, but on the other hand, it's always been there, buried deep in my psyche.
Well, I'm going down to western Kentucky, back to a small town where I was born, 25 miles east of the Mississippi River and 150 miles north of Elvis Presley's home.
Thomas Wolfe warned you can't go home again, and that's true, you can't go back to the way things were. Or can you? On the occasion of my 40th high school reunion, I want to try to go home again, to find the Mayfield I remember growing up. It may not exist in brick and mortar anymore, and the people have changed, but I know it exists in memories. And I think I can find it with a little help from my classmates and other longtime residents. Somehow I convinced Betsy Cook to undertake this journey with me. I'm as curious as anyone to see what we find.
Life in Mayfield when I was a child seemed pretty exciting. There was always the feeling that at any moment something surprising could happen, and maybe a bit dangerous too. But fun, more than anything else. To a 7-year-old, the thrills of an ice cream soda at Rexall's streamlined counter, or a silver robot man in the window of Newberry's, were equally ordinary and extraordinary. They fit perfectly into that world where people roamed the town sidewalks in Halloween costumes, or wore pajamas to come shopping at midnight. There was a center to the place. In the generation before ours, people brought their babies to the courthouse square and parked them while they gathered to talk on into the evening. In ours, old men still played checkers along the low stone walls. The hot tamale man pushed his shiny cart along 8th Street and wrapped his exotic wares in pages of the Newsy News. During the tobacco festival, the MHS band marched upright and proper, but the Dunbar band swaggered down the street with the coolest drumming ever. The floats were child's eye candy. The excitement belonged to all ages. At those parades, people lined the streets 5 deep. Among them were many characters we all knew. Some were a little scary. Despite the fact that I always shivered and ran out of the way when the Ant-Man came stomping by, I understood even then that he belonged as much as I did to our community. That feeling most likely came from the fact that when things happened in our town, they seemed to include everyone. That's why the sense of a large body of people engaged in a single, often childlike activity, always pervades my memories. Even now, maybe especially now, I observe that my life in England is often directed toward a rediscovering or a reconstructing of that feeling of solidarity. So, although I'm not sure where Mark is planning to go with this bit of time traveling, I'm more than happy to join the adventure.
My family moved to Mayfield when I was about 3 1/2, so Mayfield's the first place I remember living. And we moved into the parsonage of First Baptist Church, which is here at 620 Backusburg Road, in this great old neighborhood. And there were plenty of kids on the street, and we could play, go anywhere we wanted, do anything we wanted, practically. And it was just a great place to live when you were growing up. And I've spent my entire adult life trying, unsuccessfully, to recreate that. And I suspect I'm not the only one.
We would just all congregate at street corners and, playing basketball, playing football, playing hide and seek, you know, whatever was age appropriate, you know. That's just the way we lived.
And regardless of where you lived in Mayfield in the 50s and 60s, the downtown Court Square was probably the center of your world, with Ben Franklin, Newberry's, and other exotic destinations. Today, John Davis, class of 67, is the sheriff of Graves County and is the perfect Court Square tour guide, both past and present.
So, of course, here's something that's changed. We're sitting in this beautiful little gazebo in an empty lot. And as I remembered, There was a Ben Franklin store here.
There were, if I'm not mistaken, three different stores here. And this is not a vacant lot. This is a mini park. Oh. You probably didn't recognize it as such.
Well, I probably did because I think my mother had a lot to do with it.
She did, and this gazebo is much in part thanks to her.
Yes.
Ben Franklin, the arts and crafts and dime store was here. Also, Perel and Loewenstein, the jewelry store, if you remember them, they had the front of the building was mosaic tiles, about 1 inch square.
And the clock that never moved?
And the clock that never moved.
Yeah.
And then there was a third store here, and for the life of me, I'm wanting to say it was a hardware store, perhaps owned by Robbie Robertson.
On the opposite end of the west side of the square was a favorite hangout for teens in the 50s and early 60s, Wyatt's Rexall Drugs, with its soda fountain along one wall and booths along the other. Next to it was the Exchange Bank, Mayfield's second oldest bank.
This okay.
is more like it.
Now, how many remember what was next to the Exchange Bank? Moreheads. Morehead Brothers Bookstore. And what do you remember most about Moreheads? That's where everyone bought their school books.
I'm liking this Mayfield Cardinal thing in the window.
Well, this what ties it into Mayfield. And by the way, this is Tillman Week, as some of the folks may remember. And we still recognize it here. The difference is, and I think you mentioned it earlier, they don't paint the windows downtown like they used to. And I don't know exactly when that stopped, but I think the merchants got tired of the mess after the first rain or washing and staining the sidewalks. But you remember Moreheads had magazines at the front, school books in the middle, and then on around the corner it came out on Broadway again.
But the painting the windows was a big community thing.
It was. And you probably don't remember this. There used to be a snake dance. Do you remember that?
The snake dance.
It would start at the high school, come all the way up 7th, go around the square.
The drums.
And everything. And hundreds of kids would hold hands. And snake dance is a thing of the past. The reason it stopped, about 1965, I think, they went through Newberry's and broke one of the glass windows there.
Oh.
So they kind of stopped it then. Hooligans, no doubt.
The south side of the square is the only one that today is still intact. The buildings remain. The stores, of course, have all changed.
There were a number of Jewish merchants in town, and the first two buildings from 7th Street, remember Kahn's Ladies Clothing Store and Oscar Nocklin. It was a men's clothing store. Oscar was the kind of gentleman that his first customer today was going to buy something, and often you would try on maybe a sport coat that didn't fit exactly right, and he would button it up for you. And then he would grab it behind your neck and bunch it up and say, now look how nicely that fits. But he would make a sale.
The east side of the square was anchored by Lakofsky's on one end and J.J. Newberry's on the other. In the middle was Watson's Pool Hall, a place with the most heavenly aroma from the griddle, which was blown out onto the sidewalk with a fan. No telling how many hamburgers they sold that way over the years. Inside Newberry's, there was a lunch counter where you could get a sandwich for a quarter. Amazing. And look at that, 8 waitresses on duty at one time. I think they used to sell live birds, too. Anybody remember that? Newberry's had a side entrance on East Broadway. The north side was anchored by Woolworths on one end and First National Bank on the other, with drug, clothing, shoe, and furniture stores in between. Today, most of the north side of the square is gone, mostly because of fires.
Fortunately, we can remember Old Mayfield the way it used to be, and we have these great pictures to help us remember. There were thriving businesses all over town, and it wasn't just women's clothing stores like the Vanity Shop that were elegant. The banks could be elegant, too. And amid all those retail businesses, there were plenty of little shops where men worked with machines and actually made things. By the time we reached high school, the Hall Hotel had closed, but the Melody Mart was in the basement where you could buy the latest 45. At lunchtime, workers from the Merritt and Curly plants would fill downtown stores and head for places like the Newberry's lunch counter. But it wasn't all work. I probably lived a sheltered life growing up because I don't remember the adults in Mayfield having quite this much fun in the 50s. But maybe that's where they were going at night when they got sitters for us. The American Legion building on 7th Street was a center of entertainment with its movie theater, bowling alley, and dance hall. Imagine that, a dance hall in Mayfield. That's actually an orchestra you see in the background. When we were old enough to go to the movies, we went to the Prince's Theater on West Broadway, and in its day it was quite a place, with a stage and ornate decor, and it was the place to be on Friday night. Interesting story about this particular picture. Notice the crowd outside is all made up of men. Inside, the audience was completely made up of women. The reason? The movie was about childbirth, and it wasn't considered proper for men and women to see it in mixed company. Those were the times in which we lived. While much of the old Mayfield is gone, parts of it are still around, though sometimes in a different form. And it's these memories of old Mayfield and an appreciation for what survived that draws us back. Mayfield's Bobby Ann Mason wrote, "We were always free to roam because we knew where home was."
At Wilma's Country Kitchen, you get a plate lunch with cold bread. Carl's Barn's barbecue, a chili dog at Hill's Drive-In. There's a church on every corner and you can hardly find a beer. They don't worry about tomorrow, they know the end of the world is drawing near.
So here we are, 40 years since graduating as the Mayfield High School class of 1969. It's time to join Sherman and Mr. Peabody in the Wayback Machine and do some real-time travel. Long before we entered Mayfield High School, we were elementary students attending Lee, Longfellow, Dunbar, Washington, and East College. From 1957 to 1964, we lived the typical small-town life, shielded from the tumult of the 1960s that was just beginning to gather in the world outside Mayfield. Those of us in our school bands joined our peers from other schools in the cadet band. Somehow David Winslow was able to get us to play together in concerts like this one. In the fall of 1964, we left the comfort of elementary school for a new location. I don't know about you, but to me, this will always be Mayfield High School. Our class spent 5 years here, if you count eighth grade, and when they decided to tear the buildings down, you couldn't help but feel a little sentimental. I remember carving my initials on one of the banisters, along with students who had attended decades before me, and I remember thinking at the time my initials would always be there. I guess that ended up in the trash pile. They did save two of the original buildings, the auditorium and the gymnasium, and both buildings are still used by Mayfield Middle School today. For us, both are still filled with special memories.
Well, here's one place I feel at home, in the gym. Looking back in all the Cardinals, I see that I like to get up and do a bit of performing in school. And I was sitting in this room on the afternoon of the regional tournament doing a pep rally with Jan Rather, and "Ode to Billy Joe" was a big hit at that time, and we'd rewritten the words to that. And funnily enough, that tape turned up in the vaults just the other day, so we're gonna give you a little taste of that. Our voices were very high then.
It was the 3rd of March, another sleepy Mayfield day.
We were in the gym yelling, "Cards go all the way." And then all at once the fans jumped to their feet. And then they hollered out, "You know we can't be beat." And then Coach
cats were out to feed the red, red bird. And Jacob started to say to the fans,
the gym was the scene of school spirit and athletic performance. Down the hall was a venue for performance of another kind.
This is the auditorium, and it's one of two remaining buildings of the old high school. And during the spring of our senior year, it was sort of our home away from home as we began senior play practice. The play was Best Foot Forward, as I recall. And one night at rehearsal, I brought my father's old camera and took a few photographs.
And then there was Barclay Jones, part principal, part ham actor, part dictator. Barclay had been principal for over a decade by the time the class of 69 reached the spring of our senior year. And the spring was the time of the school year Barclay lived for, when once again he would direct the senior play, an activity he made clear was not for the meek of heart.
And I assume that all of you feel that you can help me in some way, that you would be willing to work with me in this effort. I want to tell you now, as I tell them every year, there will be times when you will literally despise me. I do not intentionally make it so, but I am reaching for a goal. And I'm going to get that goal one way or another. But I'll guarantee you this, or I hope and pray this, that when it's all over, those feelings will have culminated into an entirely different attitude. I feel very humble. I feel very lonesome. When I came in here tonight and no one was here, and yet I can look around and at every spot on this stage, every spot on this stage, I see faces that are not here anymore. Because I'll make this statement now, and I'll make it several times later, that those who are lucky enough to be a part of this work will become a part of me.
Barclay may have been a larger-than-life presence during our 5 years at MHS, but we were lucky to have many other teachers who went about their day-to-day tasks with a lot less drama, and who made sure we got an education. Looking back, we see that several of them made lasting impressions.
Shirley Ford, of course, because after having Shirley, I wanted to be an English teacher, and started out majoring in English, and made B's in English and A's in math, so I became a math teacher.
Well, Evelyn Kesterson, because I became a librarian, she definitely made an impression on me. Shirley Ford, with English. Dorothy Spar, I liked World Civ and got more interested in that because of her.
Coach Mack.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was pretty special, wasn't he?
Very special.
Lewis McDonald, no one ever called him Lewis, Coach Mack was a universal favorite.
He had a biology class, and my best friend, Steve Lote, and I were in the class together. And we decided we needed a bunch of formaldehyde, which Coach Max, as a biology teacher, he had all these things pickled in a storeroom. So we got some like brown drugstore bottles, and we were filling them up with our formaldehyde and capping them. Well, Steve realized that actually what we had done is we had gotten nitric acid and formaldehyde mixed. And I don't know what the chemical reaction is, but there's definitely a chemical reaction because that bottle started getting real hot. And Steve, being the chemist, I think he may have worked it out in his mind. He knew that there was a big reaction going on. It wasn't good. And so I was kind of standing there puzzled, and Steve literally kind of ran away from the bottle, and Coach Mack picks up the bottle, and he starts to uncap it. The thing literally explodes. Well, it seemed to be no harm done. He seemed to get some on his shirt, and he washed his hands off and all that. Well, by the end of the class, we noticed that his tie had rotted off right at the knot.
A lot of teachers, the teachers were older then, and a
lot of them were pretty special. When you look back at the time, you didn't realize it, but a lot of them were pretty special. And we got to have one class together, Coach Don.
Coach Don Sparks.
That was fun. Was it government?
Yeah.
I think that's the only class we ever got to have together.
I remember that class because I think Jim Pickens and I and maybe two or three more were the only guys in there. We sat up front so we could always look in the back. That was years of the miniskirts, you know. Mm-hmm. It was always a lot of fun to look back at the classroom.
Yeah.
And we always jumped out the windows. We worked on our sprints. We had it right before lunch, and we chased. We ran to
Fuller's.
Ran to Fuller's every day for lunch.
Oh, I'd forgotten about Fuller's.
Yeah, I can see we have to finish each. We can't. It takes two to remember all thought here. It's not good.
While all of our teachers labored to try and teach us something during our 5 years at MHS, no one ever did it with as much style and effectiveness as Shirley Ford. For me, her junior English class woke me from what was a sleepwalk through high school. She was one of those teachers who literally could and did change lives.
We were put together by Shirley Ford, actually. She's the one that
she
told me that Anne Marie wanted to go out with me, actually.
Oh, it was that way, huh?
That's the way it was, yeah.
Oh, okay.
We had to write three wishes, and for some reason I put, I wish I could go out with Robert Barkley. And I don't even know why, because I wasn't that crazy about him.
So, I want to get this straight. Shirley Ford had a major impact on both your lives.
You could put it that way, yeah, actually.
Yeah.
Very major.
Very nicely.
And, of course, there was Florence Wyman, who lived with her sister and fellow teacher, Emma. This is the only photograph in known existence of Miss Florence. It was her official photo, and I'm sure the only one she ever authorized. And while we only have this one photo to remember her by, we did find this audio recording when she spoke to an assembly in the spring of 1968.
I said to some members of the faculty, I thought I had had every experience that I could have, but I was mistaken. Last Saturday, I received an anonymous letter in the mail. It wasn't the first anonymous letter I had ever received, but it was different from any I had ever received. The letter said in beginning, this letter will be signed not with a name, but with a heart.
Though Miss Florence and Miss Emma could be intimidating personalities, filling the average student with mortal fear, some were able to establish personal friendships.
I would go see them at their home, and that was interesting, to walk into the home. You know, we would see them walking each morning down the sidewalk as we were driving to park our cars and all, and then to see how they lived. You know, it was the high ceilings, the old type house. It was, I guess, a bit primitive. You know, I'm sure they didn't go to any extravagances, but and they gave me a recipe for rhubarb pie, and I had to make it. I can't say that I ever made it again, but
Florence Wyman would end her 46-year career with our class, teaching less than half the year. And right up until the end, she continued in her own way to have a profound and lasting impact on her students.
Early in the school year, Miss Florence assigned a term paper, and to everyone's surprise, she really liked mine. After I turned it in, I was summoned to her office, and she asked me where I was going to college. And I told her, and she asked me what I was majoring in. And I hadn't given that a thought, so I said, I don't know. And she quite matter-of-factly announced, you will major in journalism. So I did, and it changed my life.
Of course, school was more than just homeroom and homework. There were plenty of extracurricular activities, and most of us seemed to find something that interested us. Maybe music, athletics, or any other of the many clubs on offer. It wasn't always easy to fit in, but square pegs could usually find something in their shape. Outside of school, A favorite pastime was riding around, usually with a stop at Hill's Drive-In or the Dairy Queen.
Were you a habitué of the Hill's Drive-In to Dairy Queen?
Yes, I drove the circuit.
Did you?
Yeah, I guess that's another thing is, you know, how many hours and weekends we spent just driving back and forth. Of course, you know, in one sense you say, well, how could that be fun? Well, it was fun because it was social. I mean, you were visiting friends and trying to make contact with girls and all that. And I mean, so it was actually exciting in a way, at least to us at age 16.
Hills made super flat hamburgers long before SpongeBob invented Krabby Patties. And the frozen malts were pure heaven. Hills was the place to see people and to be seen, usually while sitting in your car listening to tunes on Mayfield's local radio station, WNGO.
Put on a happy face,
whistle a happy tune. Good afternoon.
As we got ready to graduate in the spring of 69, our lives seemed far away from the turbulence of the outside world. The war raged in Vietnam, but it didn't seem to affect many of us. The struggle for civil rights was met with shocking violence 150 miles south in Memphis, but was mostly ignored in Mayfield. Our school was integrated in name, but, sad to say, not really in spirit. We would take our innocence out into the world and make our way for better or worse. Close friendships might become less close over time, but they were easily rediscovered when old friends managed to get together. Our yearbooks gathered dust on the shelf until they began to resemble our parents' yearbooks, the ones we used to thumb through as kids. Then life got more complicated. Children grew up, we buried parents, and one day we looked in the mirror and were startled by the middle-aged person looking back at us.
Sweetnesses, your troubles will be healed.